Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Crossing Borders, Stories of Struggle, Survival, and Community. My name is Viet Thanh Nguyen. I'm your moderator for this fantastic event today. Just want to reinforce what we heard, that our authors will be signing books later, right after this panel, upstairs. So please come on by and say hello and have your book signed. What I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce our three panelists, and then we're going to get right into it for about 40 minutes or so. And at the end, we'll take questions from the audience. I know you all have questions. And it's going to be fabulous. Okay, so first to my left is Natalia Molina. She is a distinguished professor in the Department of American Studies and Ethnicity at USC, and my colleague. Her research explores the intertwined histories of race, place, gender, culture, and citizenship. She is the author of the award-winning books, How Race is Made in America, Immigration, Citizenship, and the Historical Power of Racial Scripts, and the second book, Fit to be Citizens, Public Health and Race in Los Angeles, 1879 to 1940. Her most recent book, what we're going to be talking about today, is A Place at the Nayarit, How a Mexican Restaurant Nourished a Community, on immigrant workers as placemakers, including her grandmother, who nurtured and fed the community through the restaurants they established, which served as urban anchors. She is now at work on a new book. God, you're so productive. The Silent Hands That Shaped the Huntington, the History of Its Mexican Workers. We've known each other for a long time. We actually were young professors, and we went to Japan together back in 2007. And we were such a coup to raid UC San Diego and bring Natalia here. Next is Joan Flores-Villalobos. She is an assistant professor in the Department of History at USC. She received her PhD in African Diaspora History from New York University in 2018. We think of that as USC East. She previously taught as assistant professor at The Ohio State University, so we rated Ohio State as well. Her work focuses on histories of race, gender, and diaspora in Latin America and the Caribbean. Her first book, what we'll be talking about today, is The Silver Women, How Black Women's Labor Made the Panama Canal, was recently published with the University of Pennsylvania Press. At USC, Professor Flores-Villalobos teaches courses on Afro-Latin America and the African diaspora, U.S. empire, gender and migration, and the Caribbean. And then, Lan Duong is an associate professor in cinema and media studies at USC. She's the author of Nothing Follows, the book of poetry she'll be talking about today, and her first book, Treacherous Subjects, Gender, Culture, and Trans-Vietnamese Feminism. Dr. Jung's second book project, Transnational Vietnamese Cinemas and the Archives of Memory, examines Vietnamese cinema from its inception to the present day. Her research interests include feminist film theory, post-colonial literature, and Asian American film and literature. She is a founding member of the Critical Refugee Studies Collective, and she currently serves as the website editor for that group and is co-editor for the series Critical Refugee Studies at the University of California Press. So all three of these scholars and writers are part of what we informally dubbed the Badass Women's Collective in the back, I believe. I think that was our consensus that would have been an equally effective title for this panel. But the title is Crossing Borders, Stories of Struggle, Survival, and Community. We'll be touching on all of those ideas and keywords. And first, I'm going to start off with a question for each of our panelists, beginning with, in alphabetical order, Lan. So Nothing Follows is your first book of poetry, but your career has been as a scholar of Vietnamese cinema, and you have a doctorate in comparative literature. And your first book is actually about Vietnamese feminism. So where did the urge to write poetry come from?
This is such a great question, but before I talk about the book, I also wanted to say thank you all for coming on a very sunny day in order to hear poetry and to hear more about our writing. So yes, Viet, I am first a poet and then grad school just grounded out of me, right, as it does. And then I became an academic. 25 years later, this book came to life as a material object. And it was only through the pandemic, the worst of the pandemic that I was able to say, I want this out in the world. I want my stories, my family's stories, to be recorded, documented, and archived. My father's 93 years old. We won't know if he will see 94, but until then, I want his stories to be commemorated in some way. So 25 years later, it took so long because part of it was this fear of being a traitor to my family. And in being a writer, a memoir writer, a poet, a woman of color, I write about this in the first book about how for women of color writers, it can always be a betrayal. You can always be seen as a traitor to your own family, to your community, to your country, to the nation state, when you become a writer and you articulate what is most personal and political and important to you. So for a very long time, I was afraid. But again, the pandemic made me so angry. I'm still angry. I'm still fighting. But there's so much rage and grief that made me want to make this book come alive for myself and for the audience that I mean to create, for all those young refugee kids who came or who are still coming and need to find themselves in words.
I was around 25 years ago when I first heard some of these poems. So so much of what you said is resonant for many of us who are writers. You know, fear. Writing is oftentimes you have to confront your fear, the fear of being a traitor too. I mean, this is about a community, this panel. But you know, what does it mean to write something when it's not just about representing your community or serving your community, but might include betraying your family or your community? I'm wondering if you can elaborate on that.
Because it's very personal, and it's autobiographical to a certain point, and in so doing, a lot of secrets are exposed, a lot of violence, a lot of anger, and it's not becoming of an Asian American woman, right? As I've been taught and told, but I've also become very disobedient, a daughter, and I now am able to embrace the traitor identity or, you know, accusations of treason. And I encourage that, actually. So my book and my writings, my scholarly work and my creative work is about how we understand female-identifying subjects and who want to out themselves as traitors, and embracing that and telling our stories regardless.
We'll return to all of those themes. Joanne, the Silver Women, How Black Women's Labor Made the Panama Canal, is your first book. And I remember writing my first academic book, how challenging that was for me. So maybe we'll hear about some of the challenges you might have faced. But tell us a little bit about the subject of your book and how you came about it.
It was actually really easy. I'm joking. The book came about, you know, for both personal and academic reasons. I'm from Venezuela, not from Panama. But my family started moving out of Venezuela as part of a broader refugee crisis happening there. And Panama happens to be one of the biggest sites of the Venezuelan migration in the past couple of decades. So it's become, and until recently, had open borders for Venezuelans to travel there. You didn't need visas. So it became a central gathering place for a lot of my family that had been scattered around the world, who could perhaps not travel other places like the U.S. So I began to visit Panama a lot, visiting there with my family, being ultra conscious of the difficulties of migration and the ways that the women in my family were the ones creating the links among all our family members. Mm-hmm. At the same time, as I'm going to Panama, I start learning about its history and learning about the Panama Canal, which totally defines Panama. And in particular, I started to see this kind of vast gap between the way really official histories of the Panama Canal told that story, let's say in the main museum, or if you go visit the locks of the Panama Canal, you hear a story that's about U.S. knowledge and wealth and empire and engineering and technocracy, a little bit about labor, and that's pretty much it. You hear a very, very, very different story when you go to the communities of the Black West Indian workers who built the canal, right? And that community is still alive and well in Panama. They live in the same neighborhoods they lived in during the construction. They have their own community institutions, like the West Indian Museum of Panama, which is a much less well-funded and much smaller institution than the Canal Museum. And there they tell a really different story, right? It's one where migrant labor is at the forefront and where women's work is everywhere, right? So actually the centerpiece of that museum is a recreation of a kitchen placed in the veranda of a tenement home, which is where a lot of the migrant laborers lived. And the kitchens had to be outside because they were all made of wood and it was too big of a fire hazard to have the kitchen inside, right? So at the center of this museum is women's work. And I was so struck by that gap, and my book really came out of trying to bridge it and think about that silence. And so my book centers Black West Indian women and thinks about the labor, the care work that they provided, the domestic work that they provided that really made the Panama Canal construction possible.
Well, you know, Lan brought the issues of, you know, her own work transgressing certain kinds of boundaries and borders of expectations and norms. I'm wondering in your work whether you felt that you were confronting, you mentioned silences, for example, but, and you mentioned like the sort of the U.S.-centric history that you encountered in Panama. Were those some of the boundaries and borders that you felt you were transgressing, or were there other kinds of obstacles or expectations that you felt you were pushing against with this book?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I would actually say one of the bigger boundaries I was pushing against is the story that gets told in Panama. Because, of course, in Panama, there's an idea that they need to, as a nation, right, their national identity is really dependent on taking the story of the canal away from the U.S. But to them, the Black West Indian workers who came as migrant laborers during the U.S. construction are also part of that, right? And so they are also excluded from understandings of national history in Panama. And Blackness and Caribbeanness is seen as this complete other, even now 100 years after these people have lived in Panama, we're at the third or fourth generation of families who have lived there forever, right? And so it's actually talking to Panamanians and Panamanian scholars who are really, really resistant to having conversations about Black West Indians as a deep part of Panamanian history.
Well, that's really fascinating. We're going to get to some of these themes of multiple layers of otherness as well as we come along. But Natalia, a place at the Nayarit, how a Mexican restaurant nourished a community, is something of a departure from your first two books, which were solidly academic. This one is too, but it's also very personal. And maybe some of the history of the Nayarit will resonate with folks in the audience who are from LA as well. But what compelled you to take that personal turn with this book?
Really resonating with what you both said, that idea of there are certain stories you don't tell, you're taught not to. And in my case, it wasn't about being, you know, a good daughter or being disobedient. It's that, you know, being trained as an academic, you're taught that you need to have some objectivity, some distance between your subject. I mean, to the point that when I was an undergraduate, I took a Latin American studies class, and the professor told all the Latino students in the class, you'll never be Latin American historians. You wouldn't be objective enough. And even just kind of in the debates, right, the subjectivity-objectivity question is very big in academia and how you're proving this worth. And I think what we have in common a little bit there is that 25 years later, there's something that happens to women in this time of life where you're like, we are done asking permission. We are done. We are, call us disobedient, call us whatever you want. We are done. And so this was a way, and in doing that, it's amazing, right? You think you're unique in telling this story, but once you do, everybody feels seen because they also haven't been able to tell their stories. And so this was a way of saying, I've looked at the immigration on Mexican immigration. Women are absent in it. I've looked at the literature on entrepreneurs and people who make the city a place worth living in. Women are absent in it. Immigrants are absent in it. I've lived in Echo Park. I know that, you know, this is not my subjective view. I can tell you by looking at decades and decades of the Los Angeles Times, certain neighborhoods are only portrayed in a flat, stereotypical way, including Echo Park. And so this is a way of saying, you know what? There was life before gentrification came to Echo Park, and I would like to tell its story.
Yeah, I mean, so much of what you talk about also resonates with me. You know, this idea that so many of us are too mired in our own history to write about our own history. Someone else has to come in and validate it, right? And so somehow, if you're a refugee, or if you're an immigrant, or if you're a woman of color, you're not qualified to write about your own experiences and your own history. And the other thing that you mentioned that I thought was really resonant is sometimes we feel as if our stories aren't important. And then, as you said, you tell the story, and then everybody's like, wow, I can't believe someone finally told that story, because I thought nobody was feeling this except for me. That's been your experience, too, with the Nayarit book as well?
There's a couple of things that resonate with people. The way that the literature had been written, it was written, if you're talking about 50s and 60s communities, and especially within Latino communities, if the people who kind of got their stories written and deservedly so, were the social justice actors, people in movements, people in the Chicano movements. For immigrants, when they were written about, they were farm workers and in the fields. And all that is really important history. But what if you're someone who comes to a city and tries to find a community? It makes a community by opening a restaurant, by establishing a cafe that sells Cuban espressos and Cuban pastelitos. You know, all these ways that people find their place in a city. And then what about those people that are the ones that are, bringing us our food at restaurants, serving our drinks? And because they didn't have this heroic story in that way, we didn't get a sense of their lives. And yet they were the ones that established what I call urban anchors. Many on Sunset Boulevard. So my grandmother's was Nayarit, which is now the Echo Nightclub, Barragans, El Chavo, El Conquistador, La Vía Tasco. And I think for many people familiar with that area, they're like, oh, that is that place where I went and I felt comfortable, and I still miss it. So.
All right, awesome. We're going to come back to some of those themes as well. But, you know, the big theme of this panel is crossing borders, stories of struggle, survival, and community. And I'd like to ask each of you to reflect on that theme and its keywords of border crossing, struggling, survival, community, in relationship to your books and or your personal life and career. We're going to start with Natalia.
I'll return to sort of the way that these stories have been told. So there's much hardship in a migration story, and especially if you're working class. So, you know, if we're talking about farm workers, if we're talking about people that worked on the railroads, and people tell me those stories as I go around giving book talks. So one of the things I want to get across in the book is that these spaces, while they're businesses and they're only semi-public, that they're still more democratic at times than public spaces. For example, we think about segregation as only happening in the South. We think about segregation in black and white terms, but here in Los Angeles, we had segregation, including at public pools, where Mexicans could go the day before the pool was drained. And so one of the men that came up to me at the book signing told me the story of his dad, who worked as a laborer at a place called Simon's Brickyard. And so they embraced that stereotype of the dirty Mexican. He said that they would cover themselves with brick dust that they had manufactured, then go to the pool, then jump in the pool and get the water dirty. I want to acknowledge those stories that people have worked hard. But I do also think there's a danger in that when we always tell migrant stories, refugee stories, as these are the people that worked hard, kept their heads down, sacrificed that their children could have a better life. then we don't have a sense of who they are in their full three dimensions. We don't have a sense that they also have moments of joy and want happiness and want those things for themselves too. And if we don't see them in those three-dimensional lives, we also don't see that some of the things that they should be afforded are rights.
Joanne, how about you?
Yeah, I mean, this book has a lot of stories of struggle. The Panama Canal construction period was just a tough time in general, and West Indian migrant laborers faced a lot of difficulties. In particular, so of the death toll of the Panama Canal construction, which was quite high, 80% of the deaths were West Indian workers. It was just massively disproportionate, right? And they faced very strict racial segregation and discrimination, essentially Jim Crow style, but they called it the role system. My book partly tells that story, right? It tells of how this racial discrimination and the kind of eye of surveillance of the U.S. administration fell upon Black women in particular who were, you know, suspected of being sex workers or of bringing disease, et cetera, et cetera. But mostly it's a story of how Black women managed to kind of evade that eye so much. Because they worked in informal labor, because they knew how to navigate multilingual, multi-imperial spaces, they were able to kind of create their own community centers and really help their own community survive in the spaces where the U.S. administration was not providing for them, right? So, for example, when the U.S. Fed West Indian laborers essentially inedible food, it was West Indian women who came in and passed around food for breakfast to the workers in the morning, right? So it's really a story of their survival and of creating that for their community. And the last thing I'll say about the point of community is that, just because of the way we've been talking about it, I want to reiterate that I'm not telling a story that is unknown or untold among that community. They know it, and they know it well, and they tell it often. It is just that that's not the story that is part of officialdom, right? But I'm not kind of giving voice to a voiceless. They are loud, and they want this story told, and they have been part of how I write this book. And that's been such an important part of how community takes place in this book as well.
Len.
So I'm thinking about crossing borders, and of course our family crossed borders in 1975 from Saigon, and I became a refugee. So, but in terms of crossing spaces and boundaries and borders, this book is a testament to writing, rewriting what is personal into what is public, and I think that's very important for writers to understand or to embrace even that what I would like to show is the kinds of interiorities that we don't often see as war stories or as universal stories. And so I embrace the fact that what I'm telling these stories from the inside, and it's the book is about radical vulnerability to a large extent, to show to a public that this is not only my story, but it's deeply personal, political, and I'm trying to also embrace the idea that my family's stories are important in this regard. So for me, it is about crossing from the personal to the political, from the personal or from the interior to the public. And those crossing borders are important acts for me as I tell stories about refugee girlhoods, about refugee trauma, but also, as Natalia has talked about, refugee joy. And in so doing, mapping out in terms of crisscrossing the kinds of neighborhoods and the city of San Jose where I was raised.
Could we hear a poem from Nothing Follows?
This one is actually called San Jose 1980. Is anybody here from San Jose? Right. So this is both an homage but a takedown of my hometown. San Jose, 1980. Long-haired, dusty, bell-bottomed, emerging like wild things from our wagon. And once again, we are what we carry. Clothes, pans, secondhand sandals. In our fists are rosaries and several scapulars each. A wooden clock in the shape of Vietnam is what father brings into the new house, two battered hands on north and south. We left butler, government cheese, a black clapboard house, railroad tracks, white Catholics sponsoring us from Vietnam to Guam. Some of them calling us gooks. No wonder we are here. No wonder we sisters speak of suicide and other dirty stories. No wonder father cannot lose his bearings, his temper, his tongue. At six, I am all eyes, full of spit and spite. I am here, and it's a wonder just to begin again. Thank you.
Thank you. Joanne, how about you? A little bit from Silver Women?
Lan, that was so dope. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to read one short paragraph that is drawn from, just for context, it's drawn from the oral history of this woman's granddaughter. Emily Amelia Griffith must have sailed up to Colon in 1910 feeling a mix of fear and hope. She was finally making her way to Panama to join her partner William after he had left, like many other Barbadians, to find work as a blacksmith on the canal construction years prior. They were to be married in a Protestant church in Empire once she arrived. Emily Amelia traveled with her first child, a young toddler sick with what old-timers called the pox. In Panama, she took her daughter to Gorja's hospital, hoping the American doctors could stem the fever. The doctors put an ice pack on Emily Amelia's daughter, but it was too late. She died at Gorja's and was buried at the segregated Silver Cemetery in Corozal. Emily Amelia's first moments in Panama were a mother's worst nightmare. She could not have known then that she would live many years in the canal zone. She could not have known she would have 9 other children in Panama, though nothing could make up for the loss of her first. She could not have known that she would own property on Panamanian territory in the neighborhood of Rio Abajo, founded by West Indian immigrants. In 1910, Emily Amelia might have felt her hopes for the future diminish as she came face to face with the ambiguous promise of life in Panama.
Thanks, Joanne. Now something from a place of the Nayarit.
As you had said earlier, Viet, my other books were academic, more academic, and what I really wanted to get out of this book was to get so that other people wouldn't wait to have permission to tell their stories. But even if you want to tell your story, sometimes you don't necessarily have the tools. You aren't necessarily taking these classes where people teach you how to do that. And so I also wanted to be really transparent in the writing of the book, the silences that I came across, and also the tools that I used to tell these stories. The community that grew up around the Nayarit remains tethered to one another till today. I think about this community when I eat from the dishes given to me by my mother that Doña Natalia collected. They're from the ceramics plant in Atwater, hand-painted with apples and leaves around the edges. The plant has since closed, but it's a popular pattern. As a kid watching I Love Lucy, my first English lessons growing up in a Spanish-speaking household, I noticed that the Ricardos owned the Franciscan ivy pattern. Those dishes say a lot about my reserved grandmother. She wanted the elegant tableware, and she got it for herself, piece by piece. I like to imagine her setting her place and enjoying the sheen and the color of those dishes, not just as a sign of aspiration, but also as a way of embracing the place where she lived and asserting her belonging.
So we have about 9 more minutes before we get to the questions from the audience. So I want you to start thinking about those questions. I have a bunch of questions for you, all of you. So one thing that, Joanne, you mentioned in the context of Panama and the women that you're working about on is that they're not voiceless. The community is not voiceless. There's all these stories, and they're loud. Reminds me of things I've said about the Vietnamese refugee community as well, you know, because I've been called a voice for the voiceless, and I'm like, have you ever been to a Vietnamese household, a Vietnamese restaurant? We're really, really loud. It also reminds me of something Arundhati Roy said, which is that there's really no such thing as the voiceless. There's only the silenced or the unheard. So I would love for all three of you to reflect on this kind of problem or this challenge or this reality of the fact that you all come from or you work on communities that are replete with stories, with voices, with multiplicities of possibility that are out there. And if you can speak the language or if you're immersed in the community, you're always exposed to these things. And then you've become academics or writers or both and so on. And then you're put in this situation where you are speaking, not necessarily for them, but you know they're not here. They're not here right now. You're here. And then you're the ones with the books that will get reviewed in the newspapers and in the literary journals and the magazines and so on. I'm just wondering how you think about that in your own work, your own ethic, your own art, and any one of you could start with that. Anybody.
I'm happy to go. I think about this all the time. So, yes, this is kind of the central ethical question of my work, but also the central methodological question. One of the places this book came from where this book came is in talking to people in the Caribbean, in the islands. If you go to Barbados, if you go to Jamaica, and you ask anybody about the Panama Canal construction, every single person will tell you they remember somebody in their family who went there. And so to me, the vividness of that memory in the islands was so separate, again, from how the story was told. So I honor the way the community remembers their families and their ancestors. But my book is really an exploration of how is it that those histories have silenced the role of Black women, right? And partly it's because the historical documents tell us a very different story, a story of criminalization, of surveillance, of sexualization. And so really the work that I try to do women at every turn and try to turn them around, right? And ask different questions of those sources and see a document that was meant to be pornographic or criminalizing and instead ask, what did it mean for that woman, right? What was her experience? What can we learn about what she was doing within her community to think about these histories in a really different way? And that is work that is alongside but not the same as what the community is doing in terms of trying to really track the stories of their families, right? Which partly come into my book, but again, are a different method at getting at the same objective.
Yeah, I also think about this a lot, Joanne, and one of the things that I'd like to explore is the idea of silence. I think in homes, and this is that focus on the interiority that's so important to me, is it's in the home that there are so many silences, especially about our own history, because our parents, our grandparents are not able to speak about the trauma. But there's something very articulate and telling about these silences that I'd like to have us think about. And so the silences is what's important to me and what I want to flesh out. And eventually talk about silence as acts of refusal or acts of agency and not acts of passivity. And so for me to really bring that into motion or practice is to talk about then silence and what I can interpret from this within the space of the household. So one of the things that I've interpreted as a result from thinking through the home is the idea that there are so many different kinds of feminisms that I witnessed, that I want to bring out and talk about, that Western feminism cannot name. So this part of this book and also my scholarship is about naming that which has not yet been named and putting together a vocabulary for young folks like us. And so this speaks to the question of audience and questions of silence and being heard. Once I figured out who my audience was, it was very clarifying. I don't need to speak to everybody. I'm not always going to be heard. There are moments where people will turn me off, but that's okay because I'm creating my own audience regardless.
I'm so moved. I had mentioned before that, you know, people have been sharing their stories with me. And so I've even started this newsletter because I'm still processing like what I do when people share these stories. And my brother's a bartender and he works at an Elks Lodge. And he said, you know, a lot of the people there at the Elks Lodge would be interested in your book, but they're not going to go see you at a bookstore necessarily. I'm going to host a book event for you at a bar. So we did, and Romans provided books. Thank you, Romans. And so I read that passage. It was the first time I read that passage. And I said, you know, I know you're not going to write a book or probably even do a blog post or like a fancy Instagram post, but I'm wondering if you've shared your own stories with your family. And of course, it was the hands of the women that went up in the room. And this one woman just right away said, I have my grandmother's sewing machine, and she taught me to sew on it. And I made a dress for my mom, and my mom has since passed, but I still have the dress, and I still wear it. And this other woman, and people will often address me at these things as mija, like daughter, even though we don't know each other, right? But it's that way of, like, people feel seen. And this woman said, you know, my mother also collected dishes, not the same ones your grandmother did, but through blue chip stamps. And every week she'd collect a dish. And I just passed those dishes on to my daughter, and I never told her that story of struggle. And, you know, there's such a beauty and joy in these stories, but we are also, and there's an article on it in the LA Times this week, and I haven't read this specific one, but I've been researching it. We're also at the moment the highest high point of book banning since the McCarthy era right now. And these aren't just, you know, kind of spontaneous things. These are coordinated acts. And so I have to give this other talk coming up. And so I've been researching it. And two of the things I found out were just fascinating. These are the two things that have stood out to me that I thought were fascinating. That one, the majority of books in which people are banned for, the characters are LGBTQ, or people of color, or women, and the stories they tell are about equality. And the second point is that 74% of the book bans are nonfiction. So this isn't even about a matter of getting facts straight. This is a matter about the power of imagination and trying to shut down people's stories. And so the fact that even we're here today and we're still trying to connect with one another through people's stories is a testament to that power, that struggle that still wants to continue. But I think it's also important to keep in context that we're doing so in a moment where people are trying to shut down people's stories.
LGBTQ women, people of color, that's the majority of the country. So I think we have to keep that in mind as we talk about, you know, silences and voices and so on, that we're not talking about necessarily so-called minorities, but if we talk about all these people, this is the majority. And I think that is something to consider in terms of power and voice and who gets to speak and who's getting shut down. I have one last question before we turn to the audience, and it's about space and place, because it's something that's come up, I think, in all of your comments. I was struck by the fact that, Natalia, you were talking about being in this bar, for example, instead of going to a bookstore. And I think that's absolutely crucial. I mean, LA Times Book Festival, USC is fabulous, but it is a sort of elite space in some ways that's different than a space in a community. And you talked about places like your family's restaurant, that these were community spaces that might have been more democratic in some ways than so-called public spaces. And I think about, you know, my parents owned a grocery store, a Vietnamese grocery store in the 70s and 80s. And that was a place that, like, I think most or all of the Vietnamese people in San Jose knew. And they would go there and they'd buy their groceries, and it would only be in Vietnamese language and Vietnamese food and everything like that. And one of the ways that immigrants and refugees and outsiders claim their place in the United States is through claiming public space, like a storefront. You know, my parents, they called their store the Saigon Mui, and they never translated it. So if you were Vietnamese, you know what Saigon Mui is. If you're not Vietnamese, you're like, Saigon what? I don't know what that is. And so that claim to public space through your storefront or your church or your restaurant and so on is actually a really defiant gesture in some ways, especially if you don't translate the name of your business or your store. And there are some Americans who would find that very threatening. Like, oh my, Monterey Park. Oh my God, Monterey Park is no longer American. Everything is China. You know, this was a thing from like 20 or 30 years ago. I'm just wondering if you can all reflect on that notion of space and place, you know, the spaces and places you're writing from and writing about, and how important it is, or I assume it's important, to claim and acknowledge the specificity of these places and spaces, whether it's the restaurant, the places of black women in Panama, you know, San Jose itself, claiming that as a Vietnamese refugee space.
I'll start by saying that while my first two books, while they were more academic, and so people say, oh, it's such a personal turn to talk about this, to me they were personal, because what they're trying to do is give me the tools to understand why when I see, and it's still this way, so I won't even just say when I was growing up, when I see Los Angeles being depicted on the screen, for example, there's never any spaces or people that look like me. I mean, even to today, Latinos make up 4% of speaking roles in film and television, even to today. So, and you know, my second I Love Lucy reference for the day, there's this season where they come to California, to Los Angeles, to Hollywood, and I thought, like, I want to go there. I didn't realize I was already there, right? Because it's depicted so differently. And growing up in Echo Park, it was just, you know, people would say, I was going to the Dodger game and I made a wrong turn. I went into this neighborhood. I'd say, that's my neighborhood. So unless we tell these stories, we just have this kind of top-down narrative of it. And we don't have a sense of how people actually live and how they connect and how people in their daily lives are regularly crossing borders and seeing someone different than themselves. And that's part of the reason that I wanted to write Echo Park, about Echo Park specifically, because it's so many of those communities that found themselves on the margins, whether they were immigrants, refugees, LGBTQ, working class, bohemian, socialists, communists. They knew there was a way of being in the world that was different than the norm. And that was enough for them to cross borders and find commonalities with others.
Yeah, I think my book is very much about place and space, in particular in thinking about, you know, when you imagine the Panama Canal construction, really obvious spaces come to mind: the lock, the ship, the ditch. And I want to kind of turn that around and think about the kitchen, the river laundry, right? These domestic spaces where that construction was also made, where black women dominated. So that's one of the important things in thinking about space. And the second, which I guess is a little bit more distinct from what we're talking about in terms of being really rooted, is that the story is also one of diaspora and one of a continued diaspora. So actually one of my most kind of successful talks was on Zoom, because West Indian Panamanians, descendants of those early laborers, live all over the place. They don't just live in Panama, they live in Cuba, they live in New York, they live in LA, they live in the islands. And to be able to really connect with all those people, you kind of have to go to all of these different places, right? And they feel that connection strongly, even from all these different spaces, which again makes total sense to me and my own family history. That's what we have to do on a daily basis, right? Like, keep up that WhatsApp chat from like different time zones. So that is also important to me, right? Thinking about how people make space from all these different locations simultaneously.
My comments on space and place are very much resonant with my colleagues here. But I do want to make a special space for San Jose, because it is the second largest Vietnamese American community outside of Vietnam. I have fond but also very violent memories of being in this working class neighborhood. And I wanted to commemorate this place. This place is important, and it takes up a whole part of section two of the book, which I title Duma San Jose, which for those of you who don't know, Vietnamese means motherfucking San Jose. And so, thank you. And when you say Đu Má, it has to be in that Đu. I mean, it's just really particular. And it's a certain lingo that I grew up with. And so not only am I talking about San Jose and my memories there, but it is to also commemorate a subculture of Vietnamese refugees or Southeast Asian refugees who were into things like fighting, right? Or new wave, both the music and the fashion, the style, and a kind of understanding of space. We saw it as the new West for us. So it was from that point of view that I mark all these places that I've been.
Thank you. Now we're going to turn to the audience for questions. Yes. Oh, so there's a mic that's going to come down. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you all for your wonderful talk. I have a question here. It's fairly open-ended, but I guess it's about the archive, and I use that term sort of liberally, because I think what everyone here is working on is the creation of some sort of narrative, and I think Joanne said it really well when she says there is sort of the narrative of officialdom, and basically my question is, partly because this is stuff that I'm preoccupied with my own dissertation, how you worked around the limitations of the official archive, which might be full of facts and figures that, you know, you feel like you're sometimes obliged to acknowledge, but, you know, there's obviously, there can sometimes be a lot of coercion and violence behind these numbers, these dry, cut and dry numbers. And of course, what you're trying to tell is a different sort of story, one that doesn't necessarily come through in that sort of dryness. So yeah, just kind of how you worked around that, how you worked with it, or, you know, how you interpreted things, you know, how you came to interpret things. Also, just as a comment to Natalia's thing about being a Latin Americanist, if you're Latinx, I mean, I wonder, it's like nobody ever tells someone in like an American history class, like, if you're white, you're never going to be a historian of the US, or you can never be a historian of Europe.
Or Latin America.
Right. It's like, no, like nobody tells you that. So I think that sort of egregious double standard is, you know, just really interesting. I mean, I've also been told once that it's like, oh, well, you should be careful of avoiding auto history. The idea that, you know, somehow your own personal experiences might, you know, affect the objectivity of what you're doing. Anyways, thank you.
Okay, this is also, my book is all about the archive as well. So the first thing I'll say is that when I first started this project, what I heard from everyone that I asked was that I wouldn't find the history of Black West Indian women anywhere. Any archive I went to, they'd be like, you're not gonna find anything about that here. There was nothing about that. And I immediately realized that was not the case. So for example, one of the sources that gets used all the time to talk about the history of the Panama Canal are three very famous memoirs written by white American women who lived there during the construction. They get cited constantly. People talk about these authors all the time to, you know, talk about daily life during the construction. And I opened them up thinking, well, you know, I have to read them. Everybody cites them. You know, obviously they won't have anything about Black women because nobody has mentioned that before. Guess what? The books were entirely about Black women, right? It was like constantly it's these white women talking about the Black women around them, right? Who were the people they were interacting with the most on a daily basis, right? The domestic servant in their home, the market women who sold them food every single day, the Black women they saw in other domestic spaces, right? And so right away at the beginning of my research, I was like, oh, so there's something weird about the way people have been talking about what has been silenced in the archive, right? So I think part of the answer to your question is actually you do have to dive into those official archives head first, because sometimes what people have told you is there is not what's there. And sometimes there are really interesting stories you can get from there. Obviously, taking on a different question and a different perspective, which, and here I have to really cite my immense debt to Black feminist scholars, Sadia Hartman, Marisa Fuentes, people like that who have done immense amounts of work, in particular with archives of enslavement and enslaved women, thinking about, right, how to approach these documents that are making enslaved women into just a number or property, et cetera. So that's part of it. And then the second part that was important to me, at least, was really expanding, again, to this diasporic archive and not just going through the root of the documents that the U.S. created, but going to the islands, going to colonial archives, going to Panama itself, which actually, before the year 2019, not a single book about the history of the Panama Canal ever used the archives of the National Archives of Panama at all, which is honestly bananas. So, you know, just kind of really expanding that work as well.
Okay, we have a question over there.
It's on. Like growing up, my parents or grandparents didn't really tell me many stories, so it was always very gray. And I feel like there was some point that I was convinced that there were stories were worth hearing and mattered. I mean, maybe you always felt this way, but do any of you have a core memory of that first time where you felt like your own stories were as important as maybe the people you grew up with?
I have a very vivid memory of, or an image, and I write about it in the poems, in one particular poem, but it is of my father who was in the South Vietnamese Army. He was a lieutenant colonel. So if we weren't evacuated from Vietnam in 75, he would have been re-educated. But he brought the Southern Vietnamese flag from Vietnam to the U.S. But we never spoke about what that meant to him, what it meant to the family or the national family. So, but I remember this flag being very beautifully wrapped. And it's a very distinctive flag, yellow on three stripes, three red stripes. But it was this triangle that he beautifully wrapped, and he put it in the closet next to vacuum cleaners and Clorox. So, it stayed there for so long, but it became this thing that I connect with him, and how his history was encapsulated in the way in which that flag was beautifully wrapped, and yet it was put into a closet for most of his life.
Nobody else? Okay. I think we have a question in the back. You had your hand raised for a while. Yeah.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for sharing the stories. My parents are from Jalisco, and my dad was a bracero. And my mom came with, you know. I grew up in the Salinas Valley. This notion of traitor is really interesting, and silence together. It's so difficult to get the stories out. My dad's now 90, and you're just on the precipice of being a traitor every time you ask something. And just wondering how to open up without causing pain, because I feel like my parents' success was because they were so stoic and optimistic. Like, don't bring it up, or it's no es nada, or we just did it. And I'd love to hear a little bit about how to bridge that a little bit without causing pain, but also not letting it all disappear, you know, saving some of it in your heart so you could pass it on to your kids.
Thank you. That's such a beautiful question. So the Bracero program was the U.S. guest worker program between the U.S. and Mexico from 1942 to 1964. And because the idea was that people would come, work, do the labor, and then go home, though, you know, some people stayed, they left the program. But there was so much hardship. There's so much silences from the people that were in the program. And it's not unusual to have a student who tells me it, when they learn about it, because some people have people who are braceros in their family, and they never talk about it. So they say, is that why my
dad is a citizen, but was raised in Mexico, and I never knew this history of my grandfather. You know, because they don't realize they had a grandfather that was here, may have had their dad, then moved back to Mexico, and then the dad migrated back on their own. So this is a question that I get sometimes. I have this newsletter on it, on, you know, consulting all these sources and how people can do it. But sometimes having those things that spark conversations, those photographs, those material objects, whether it's a dish, whether it's the sign of the cross, I have my grandmother's prayer book, these different things, and then finding spaces where that person may be more comfortable to speak. So some of my interviews I did in restaurants, people found it very awkward for someone to come into their house and want to interview them with a tape recorder or something. So I would avoid those kinds of things. You know, interviewing people in their native language, sometimes interviewing a couple of people together because one person on their own wouldn't want to tell the story. And then somebody might say, oh, remind them of this. Or somebody then, when somebody else was speaking, then wanted to top their story. So there was different strategies for different people. But one of the things you said was something that I heard all the time. We knew not to ask. We never asked. And so part of the stories that I'm hearing as people come to the book readings is people, one of them is, you know, this man said, I told my dad I was going to the reading, and, you know, he's 92, and I didn't even know how much he understood. And my dad said, yeah, I used to work there. What? Oh, that woman helped immigrate me. My mom had died, and she knew I was alone in Mexico, and she's the one who helped immigrate me, right? But it's that pain that people are covering, and so finding those ways to open space.
We have time for one very, very quick question, please, and one very quick answer, I believe.
Hi. I'm interested in your perception about how who you are impacts the information and the stories that you get. When I graduated from law school, I went to one interview in New Orleans with a law firm, and they could not tell, and this was my experience growing up, that my mother's Jewish or that my parents were civil rights activists, right? And I felt growing up often that I have like an invisibility cloak, and people would say the most racist and anti-Semitic things to me because they couldn't tell by my last name or by looking at me what my family background was. So at the conclusion of this interview, they said to me, and don't worry, we don't hire blacks and Jews. To me, the most offensive thing they could possibly say, because they didn't see it in my name or the way that I looked. And so I think who we are and how we present ourselves often impacts the information that we get. And I'm wondering how in your collecting of information you felt that who you are has impacted the stories that you get.
Maybe one very quick response, because we're up out of time.
Sure. So I'll tie this back to the archive very quickly, because the archive is also the subject of my work a lot. I have my own personal archive, and that's where I draw my poetry from. But when I'm going on to archives like in Vietnam, then it matters who I am, because I'm able to speak the language, and also I know the customs in order to talk to the officials who are running the state archives. So it absolutely matters as to who you are, and it's also very gendered. So what I mean by that is that they see me as a woman, and they will want to know very quickly if I'm married, if I have kids. It's just a rehearsal of all the things about expectations revolving around gender.
Can I say, sorry, one minor thing? I think that gives you the opportunity to become the traitor you should become. So...
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.